like to call the speakers to be with us on the podium for the discussion session. And we'll start taking questions from the female side. We will take two questions. We are late for the schedule, so maybe we'll take two questions from there and another maybe two or three questions from here. Just waiting for the speakers, then we'll start.
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Jubar Alallah. I will thank you for the panel, for the discussion and interesting topics. My question for Dr. Ali, first of all, thank you for your presentation. It was an excellent and to the point. Is there is any rule for high flow nasal cannula for the bigger baby? So if you have, for example, 34-weeker, 35-weeker, like using of the high flow nasal cannula in that age group?
Thank you for your comments. So really, I don't have the experience of using nasal cannula at all. So it's hard for me to advise something that I don't do.
Excellent.
But my inclination is, if something really is good, we should give it to everybody. If something really is not working, so why would we deny it from some group and give it to the other? That would be my problem. So if really nasal cannula is good, why don't you give it to 23-weeker, 24, 25-week? But the fact that even all the trials are giving the nasal cannula for greater than 28 weeks, they don't even have the courage to do a trial on nasal cannula in 26 weeks because we know it doesn't work. So why you'd like to try it on a 34-week if CPAP will take care of it in 12 hours, it will be off CPAP completely to room air? Why should I give it a nasal cannula and can keep dragging for days?
Any next questions from the female side?
Go ahead.
No more questions?
Thank you for all the speakers. For Dr. May regarding surfactant, just I want to clarify if you recommend to give the all babies for need for surfactant to give to increase the initial dose for surfactant as a dose, and we will double the dose. As you said, you are recommending to increase the dose as an initial doubling?
No, you don't need to increase it. No, it's actually different different product. They have a different dosing.
Yes, definitely. As if I'm using any type of surfactant, you are recommended to increase the dose as an initial dose?
No, not really. You have to go with what is what's recommended. On
yes, the same dose. Yes.
By the provider or by the distributor.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll take questions from our side here. Please, Doctor.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dr. Rissam, consultant neonatologist, Medina. My question regarding BBD, is there any studies about the relation between BBD and the overcrowdedness of the units? Because I feel that there is good relation between them, because I'm working in a small unit. I never see BBD at all. That's because there is no infection, there is low rate of infection. The new trends in United States is to make partitions, as you know, the preterm will be in the single room, like in Baltimore or other hospitals. So I don't know, is it applicable here in Saudi Arabia? Because I feel that most of the NICU units is a big hole containing, having around 30 to 50 babies together, and the infection will be transmitted from one to one. So I have a lot of babies in my unit, 23 to 24 weeks babies. All of them discharged normal brain, and only they suffer from, some of them suffer from grade 1 to 2 ROB. So is it applicable to make partitions in these big units in Saudi Arabia to make these partitions also far away from each other? So if there is any research, you can update us. Thank you very much.
If I might take this. I'm not sure if it's related to what we've talked about, but anyways, I mean, it's a very important question. The two points that you've mentioned about the size of the unit and the single room approach. With regard to the size of the unit, there has been at least three studies showing in unitology that the bigger is not the better. The bigger the unit is actually the worse the outcome for our premature babies. Units more than 30 beds has been shown to have higher mortality rates as compared to units who are at a lower size. I'm not sure about the PPD data, but those small studies looked at mortality per se. With regard to single room family centered approach that has been adopted in the last 15 years in the States, and we actually have jumped into it in Saudi lately, the latest data that I'm aware of, and when they looked at the babies in the long term with regard to cognition, babies who were catered or looked after in single rooms had a lower cognitive functions as compared to babies who were looked in the common room. So we really don't have a clear answer about that at this stage, and we have to be very careful, especially with the long-term outcomes of those babies looked after in single isolated rooms.
Thank you, Prof. Khalid. We'll take next questions. Prof. Hansen.
For interesting talks, all of you. I have actually two comments, one for Professor Ali and then for Dr. Saud in the other auditorium. I thank you warmly, Professor Ali, for your very intelligent critique of evidence-based medicine. Now, there is no doubt that evidence-based medicine has been a major step forward in scientific methodology, but we must not let the pendulum swing so far that we forget common sense. And we must recognize that the underlying premise of evidence-based medicine is that we are all alike. And if there is anything that pharmacogenetics has taught us, it is that we are definitely not all alike. So evidence-based medicine, as you so very wisely put it, you have to look at the underlying data and you really have to ask, is this question sensible? And I think that's a very well put. And to Dr. Saud, we actually in my unit in Oslo now practice minimally invasive surfactant therapy. And I was one of a group of people who went down to Cologne to visit the group who pioneered the technique. And for me, being an old guy, as you can all see, and being present and taught an unitology that was in many ways aggressive. And we talked about resuscitation. And for me to observe the practice of the group in Cologne was like a paradigmatic shift. Suddenly my eyes were open and they're underlining that this baby is not dead, so we're not reviving this baby. What we are doing is assisting transition. And I think that concept, that we're not reviving dead babies, we are assisting their transition to extrauterine life. And that sort of changes your whole approach. You become much more gentle, you become much less aggressive. So I think whether or not you go for the missed approach or not, I think the whole thinking behind it, that these babies, we don't need to jump on them. We need to gently assist them as they transit. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Prof. We'll take maybe another.
Can
Dr.
I?
May?
Yeah, thank
yes.
you. Thank you, Professor. I do agree with you. We were lucky in having actually a group from Cologne visiting us in February, last February, and Professor Rodriguez showed us a lot of videos. So our head nurse was very much interested, and all of us. So that's why we're going to try it. We're putting it together. We received the videos, and he promised that even we can go and visit him there. So hopefully we'll be able to get it done. And you're right, it's not resuscitating, it's actually supporting the baby to go through that, the transition. Thank you.
Take another question. Dr. Nimri, please.
The mic, yes, it's here. I wish I can ask all panel professors, and we are lucky that we have all professors today with us. My question to Professor Saleh Al-Alayan, I get interesting to get this genetics background for BBHN. I'm always asking myself why this premature baby with RDS goes smoothly and gets extubated, the other premature baby with the same RDS complicated with BBHN. The same thing about meconium. Why this baby lodged with a lot of meconium in his x-ray, and yet his room air, other babies get turned to. Is there any genetics studies on the gene expression for such PBHN cases in this category? Thank you.
Yeah, there are some studies, as I mentioned earlier, that genetic, the one that they were talking about, the corticotrophin, especially the binding proteins, there are like two proteins, and this is mediated through the genetic inheritance or inherited by genes, and I'm sure that we need more studies in order to explore, you know, how do they, or how are they transmitted, or how do they modulate or remodel the pulmonary vessels or vascular smooth muscles. This is very important. I'm sure that, you know, the future will give us more, you know, details about the genetic predisposing in babies who are at risk of developing PPH. And I'm not sure about, you know, the premature babies, as you mentioned, but if they have it, definitely you have to think about, you know, the causes. And sometimes even the exposure to certain, you know, stimuli, like, you know, hypoxia could, lead to gene expression that can cause, you know, muscle thickening and pulmonary hypertension. I think the area still needs more studies. I'm sure in the future we'll see, you know, cases with the, especially, you know, the PPHN that don't respond to the treatment we usually use.
You'll allow me to take another question now?
We'll give chance to the other side. If you'll, okay, any questions from the side? Dr. Ntosar, yes, please. It will be the last questions, by the way. Sorry for that.
My question for Dr. Khaled, thank you for your nice slides. Regarding dexamethasone or systemic steroids, mainly the result of the concern was about dexamethasone. Hydrocortisone, the concern was at that time for intestinal perforation, I guess. There is a recent study published last year from France. It was multicenter double-blind RCT. 1,000 baby was treated with early hydrocortisone, 14 days. And the results was promising, and the number of babies need to treat was 12. I'm just wondering, the concern was about hydrocortisone perforation when was associated with endometriosis or treating for BDA. And now they try to start it without the treating for BDA. Do you think we can apply this hydrocortisone as the same, like the dose was 1 milligram, I guess, per kg for 5 days, then 0.5. And the secondary outcome for that results was the reintubation failure was less for this baby who received hydrocortisone. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for the question. I think, as you mentioned, the studies that came from France is gives us very promising details and data with regard to the use of physiologic hydrocortisone doses for prevention of PPD. Again, it is your call as a clinician and as a practitioner and your reading of the literature and the evidence whether to adopt such a practice or not, depending on the rates of PPD in your unit, the safety of this practice. We do have the data that comes only from France with regard to hydrocortisone. Waterberg and her colleagues stopped their hydrocortisone study earlier because of perforation risk, and when they looked at the 330 babies they had in that trial, also they didn't find an increase in neurosensory impairment. So yes, it does seem that using hydrocortisone in the first 2 weeks of life in a physiologic doses does have beneficial pulmonary effect without increasing the neurosensory impairment in the future. Again, some of our units, maybe 10 to 20% of us, are still using indomethacin prophylaxis. So we should still be careful with regard to the combination of indomethacin prophylaxis and hydrocortisone in those units.
I just would like to add, because the steroids are mentioned in this session in multiple occasions, so the studies on hydrocortisone, multiple studies on hydrocortisone, they showed nothing. It's like giving water. No effect at all. Then finally, one study came from France. Finally, the p-value reached in the meta-analysis after adding all of these studies. The study from France made the p-value finally 0.05. So the routine use for hydrocortisone, I would caution against it. Instead, we offered two steroids in this session that are very effective and much less invasive. The one that Dr. Falah mentioned about using the nebulized hydrocortisone, that actually all the studies were showing previously did not have any effect, but the most recent study in New England Journal of Medicine, when you look at the bachelor, that's the largest study, it showed effect, but actually when you stratified it into intubated and non-intubated baby, it was not effective in the intubated baby. So babies who are on the ventilator receiving nebulized steroids, multiple previous studies showed no effect, and then the intubated babies in that same study also did not show effect. But the non-intubated babies, like a baby on CPAP or non-invasive PPV, did decrease the BBD. The second study that Dr. Saud brought that was done in Taiwan, it's a single study. They are adding the nebulized steroid mixed cocktail with the surfactant. So while giving surfactant, they just add a little bit when the dose is indicated. Of steroid, and this significantly decreased BBD. But the problem with this study is the only study that brought it, but it can show a huge promise, like you are trying to give surfactant, add a little bit of nebulized steroid to it, it will decrease BBD based on one single study. Thank you.
Thank you, Profali. We extend our sincere appreciation for our morning session speakers for their excellent talk.